Hi everyone, and welcome to Oakridge Presbyterian's online self-isolation service. We are so glad you could join us. Today, we celebrate our mothers on Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all, regardless if you're a mother or not. We have all had mothers and mother figures in our lives, and we give thanks to our loving God for that. The Lord is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
The Lord is good.
Because that's God's nature. Wow. As a congregation and welcome guests, Jackie and I will lead in the celebration of Holy Communion later in the service. If you would like to have elements of bread and juice ready when we lead you, that would be great. However, you can also celebrate with us without physically partaking of the elements. We always know that the Holy Spirit is present, and we receive the Lord's blessing by participating with or without the elements. Hear the call from God. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. I just have some announcements. During this COVID-19 crisis, our mission and outreach team has been monitoring the needs of the London community. The London Food Bank is of special interest because they need things such as baby supplies, diapers, baby formula, canned meat and fish, and other groceries and cash to purchase items which are desperately needed. Please bring your donations to the northwest corner of the food bank between 9 a.m. and 4 p.m. at 926 Leithorn Street in London. And there's a phone number associated. I'll give it to you. 519-659-4045. Again, 519-659-4045. We have also been a longtime supporter of mission services. In order to enable social distancing, some of the men have been moved from the men's mission to hotels and motels. This has also been the case with Rothorn Family Shelter. Because of this, extra staff have been hired to provide supervision, cleaning, and cooking needs. A special COVID-19 account has been established at Mission Services to pay for PPE gear and the extra staffing. Please send donations to Mission Services for 797 York Street, London, Ontario. And I'll give you the phone number again, 519-433-2807. This phone number is 519-433-2807. And thank you for supporting these needed charities. Now, please join us in our opening praise song. Sing praise to God on mountaintops. Then we will hear from our children's ministry leader, Sonia, who's going to tell us what kids' ministry is doing this week.
Sing praise to God where humankind its majesty. Hey everybody, it's Sonia here, and I want to wish all the moms a very happy Mother's Day. Now this week in Kidsmen, we're going to learn what is the purpose of our spiritual gifts. So check out our Kidsmen video on our YouTube channel. Now please join us as we sing Your Love Defends Me.
Time for our call to worship, and I'd just like to call Jackie forward, and she will be the responsive reader. Come and see what God has done.
How awesome His works on man's behalf.
Praise God, O peoples.
God has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping.
Amen. It is now time for our choir anthem, and this week we'll hear a past recording of the Oakridge Chancel Choir singing Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
please join us now in the prayer of adoration and confession. Shall we pray? Steadfast and loving God, you are our refuge in times of trouble and our shelter when we are afraid. In you alone, Lord, we trust. In you we see our way forward and discover what is authentic. In you we find abundant life. And so we offer you our worship and love as a God who creates and gives life to the world, as the Son who practiced the truth of the good news, and the Holy Spirit who guides us this day and always. Steadfast and loving God, we confess that while we know Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, we have often failed to follow him. We sometimes doubt his wisdom and truth. Rather than live the life he offers, we carve out our own paths and pursue our own desires. Forgive us for the many ways we have fallen short, Lord, of your purpose for our lives. Give us courage to follow Jesus, who continues to show us the way. We come to you now, Lord, in time of silent prayer, where each one of us comes to you from our own hearts. Shall we pray? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's now time for our declaration of forgiveness. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Your sins are pardoned. The penalty is paid.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Join us now in singing As Water to the Thirsty. It's number 688, verses 1 through 3 from our hymn book.
Mother's Day. I hope we all get to celebrate in nurturing and uplifting ways. May God be glorified. Sue was telling me this week, as I mentioned in the newsletter, that she and her siblings will be celebrating by taking her mother's remains up to Teeswater to her final resting place and to commend her to the loving arms of God. They'll be doing this with words and prayers and songs, but also with instruments. And so they're hoping and praying that the weather will be good so that they can use the instruments. So let's all hope and pray with them that the weather will be good for this very special service that celebrates their mother. Let us come to God with our prayer for illumination. God of the universe, reveal your presence among us through your Holy Scripture. As we listen today, warm our hearts with gratitude for the good news of Jesus Christ. Through your Holy Spirit, Empower us to stay true and committed to your way. In your name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture for this week will be Romans chapter 12, verses 9 to 21, followed by a reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 6. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And next we'll read from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 6. If I speak in the tongue of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
It's now time for our message. Shall we come to our Lord in prayer? Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditation of all our hearts together, be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It's now time for our message, and we are now in the fourth sermon in a six-week series on the true and the false self. Now, the true self is a self that theologians have talked about for many years, about not just hearing the word of God and thinking about it, but actually doing it and follow the way Jesus did it when he was here on earth. And the more we practice that, we become closer to the true self in Christ, where we are motivated in our hearts, not just by our minds, but in our hearts towards the way of Jesus. The false self is a self that is more geared towards the self and what the self wants. Sometimes we're in the false self when we are Christians in the sense that we know in our minds how to follow Jesus, but we live the religious false self where we don't do it in word and deed. And the Apostle Paul, who wrote 1 Corinthians 13 and Romans 12, which we have read today, he was living in the religious false self, and he saw the risen Christ, and he realized that he needed to live towards the truth, Jesus Christ, towards the true self. I have had it in my ministry from time to time that somebody would comment on another individual saying this, that person is or was a real Christian. I would respond by asking, what do you mean? The person would go on to say statements which were in line with Romans 12. I would suggest that the real Christian was one who was inspiring in living towards the true self, inspiring others in living towards the true self. That person would be humble, not spiritually arrogant. This person did not believe they were a better person than others. They were not competitive with others, self-righteous or judgmental, but had a deep love for God and others. A sense of joy and peacefulness would be in them, resulting from trust and connection with God in evidence of their life and the way they lived it. Now, we all want to become closer to the true self, and we do fail and we do fall into the false self. But in our sermon series, we're talking about how can we be closer to Christ and have the freedom that is experienced by that, and to be living in love and not fear. As we learn more about what a real Christian looks like, or a person which is more in line with their true selves as God was meant them to be, we shall focus on today's reading from 1 Corinthians 13, verse 6, which says, "Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing or evil, but rejoices in the truth." Do you have someone you dislike? Don't you get some satisfaction when your enemy suffers evil? For example, there is a teacher you have now or had in the past who has been unfair to you, and you find it hard to resist the feeling of satisfaction when you hear, for example, that their car had been stolen. Or you've been fired from a job, and later you hear with glee that your former boss has serious relational issues with his wife and children. Your brother-in-law has done amazingly well in real estate. And then you hear with some joy that he recently lost a significant portion of his investments in the stock market. Gossip comes out of this kind of rejoicing in evil, and it needs to stop. Rejoicing in evil is tied directly to the false self, where God's love may be professed but not lived from the heart. It was a 75th anniversary celebration of the liberation of the Nazi occupation in the Netherlands this past week, and a few days later, the official end of World War II. My mother had shared with me and my siblings the experience of joy and relief she had that day when she saw the Canadians coming in and declaring liberation of the Netherlands. 7,600 Canadian soldiers died in the nine-month campaign to liberate Holland in 1945. We are reminded of evil every day of our lives, aren't we? The problem is that we always think it is out there. How did the church in Germany follow Hitler en masse, we ask? Certainly, a minority of Christians opposed Hitler, led by individuals as Dietrich Bonhoeffer and others. We have the theology in our head, and we know what is right, but our false selves are so very strong and wrong. Sadly, we rejoice in wrongdoing, or evil, as it's written in other translations. I believe this is largely because of fear and self-preservation and the need to blame, quote, the enemy. The enemy being the foreigner, the one who is different, the group which we blame for bringing in the coronavirus, for example. We feel justified because it is someone else's fault, and then we do not need to do the hard thing at looking at ourselves. We add to the list those who have addictions, those with mental illness. The question is not about whose fault it is, but how do we show them love as Christ loved us? Group mentality builds an ideology so quickly into hate and racism that it is hard to escape from it and to see the real truth. The real truth being that highest form of love, that agape love that we read in 1 Corinthians 13, and it's based in the nature of God. And that love is about love. That love, that agape love, is about love and forgiveness. When evil happens, we are guided through the words of Romans 12 about how to respond. Quote, "Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble or what is right in the sight of all." Romans 12, verse 17. This is much easier to do when Christ becomes more the center of your life through knowing the scripture, regular prayer, and embodying Christ in your actions each day. When one knows in their heart that they are loved, then they can leave it to Christ to be the judge. It is important to remember that this is not easy, especially when one has experienced deep, deep hurt from others. However, this is the true path to peace and joy. Verse 19, quote, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, quote, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Romans 12, 19 through 21. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 6 says. You can say that if you were writing, let's say, 1 Corinthians 13, the word truth would not have been used there. In contrast to the word of wrongdoing or evil, the word goodness may have been used instead. So why then is the word truth contrasted with evil? Again, shouldn't the word goodness be used instead? To answer this, it is important to remember what truth is in the Bible. Truth is a person in the Bible. Truth is a person whose actions and words perfectly go together. Truth is a person whose human life is lived in the way God meant for it to be lived. In the Bible, truth is Jesus Christ. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And we read that in John 14, verse 6. You will hear people say that, quote, "truth is relative." This statement often refers to the subjective nature of truth from a human perspective. If we think about it, every single instance that we experience, we have to make sense of it through our own lens. This lens is a product of our relationships, our upbringing, and experiences in life and culture, and thus will affect our judgment on each experience. When truth is experienced as the love of God in Jesus Christ, every belief, thought, and action are to be weighed against Jesus Christ, the truth. Discerning from the perspective of the false self-truth is done in reference back to the self. In the true self, truth is referenced back to Christ. In Christ, one's personal experienced truth is informed by the real truth in Christ's sacrificial love on the cross for them and for all. When our focus in life becomes closer to Christ, the love of God fills the void inside of us with abundant love. This love makes us free to be who God creates us to be. Fear of scarcity for things in this world and fear of not being valued by others constricts one's freedom. In our false selves, we have the propensity to protect our vulnerable self through sweet revenge. That is, having satisfaction at another's pain. How does one draw closer to the true self, to the truth? The response? Do what the second half of verse 6 tells you to do. Be intentional about rejoicing in the truth. Rejoicing in God's steadfast love found in Jesus Christ. Rejoice in others' successes and mourn with those who are hurting. Sometimes people have to face consequences from irresponsible behavior, and we're tempted to say, "He or she got what they deserved." And that is judgmental and vengeful and in line in rejoicing in evil. A gracious response would be more like this. There are consequences to our actions and we need to learn from them, inferring that we are all tempted to sin and no one is better than another. That is more in line with the true self. It is important for an abundant life in Christ that we get in the habit of rejoicing in others' successes, keeping in mind that success in earthly life is good, but it only satisfies for a short period of time, and that success does not constitute, in the long run, who you are or your identity. What is your identity? You belong to God, and you are loved by God. Discern that your actions are in line with the truth. Academically, we have this in our heads today, that rejoicing in the truth works. It really does. Love, yes, the truth as we see in Christ will set you free. Okay then, with God's help, let's get to it. People of God, it takes daily effort, and you feel the benefits of it as you employ 1 Corinthians 13 verse 6 in your life. I'll say it again. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Are you one of these real Christian people that others are noticing? Being a real Christian does not mean you are better than others and have earned your way there. No. It is a free gift for us to receive as we follow the path of Jesus. A real Christian being closer to the true selves means you not only believe, but you also follow Jesus. And that will truly make the difference. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's now time for our offering. And there are different ways in which you can give of your offering. And you can see that on the screen, actually. At this time of social isolation where we don't have services, we have alternatives for you to give. And we are so thankful for what you have given so far. We are blessed. At this time, I would like to announce that Keirah and David Buckley will lead us in this week's offertory. Thank you, Keirah and David. It's now time for our offertory prayer. Shall we pray? Gracious God, We bless you for your gift of the life renewed through Christ's love and through springtime growth in fields and gardens. Bless the gifts we bring to you. May they offer hope and renewal in the world you love as we serve in the name of your greatest gift, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. It's now time for our prayer of thanksgiving and intercession. Just want to mention some personal prayer requests. First of all, I want to mention that Sheila Sullivan's sister-in-law has died. We prayed for her and the family last week, but she has now passed away. We want to pray for Evelyn Furness and her family. Evelyn's sister died this past week as well. Pray for Susan Leach and her family as Suzanne's aunt passed away this past week as well. We want to pray for Suzanne and her family. We also want to pray for David and Lois Hicks, whose grandson, David Jr., the cancer has come back again, and we want to hold him up in our prayers. We also want to pray for Joe Leatham, one of our members, who has taken a turn yesterday and is not doing very well, but the family has been called in. I was able to be with them as well last night, and we want to continue to pray and give thanksgiving that the family can have some visiting at this difficult time of the coronavirus. I'm going to hold Mary and the family up in prayer. Shall we come to our God in prayer? God of power and might, who raised Jesus from the dead, you free our hearts from trouble, and you prepare a place of joy for all of your children. And so, Lord, we thank you for your promise and your peace, which we need so desperately these days. In Christ, we know you are the way. You deliver all who turn to you in moments of challenge or uncertainty. We pray for those who feel lost or alone, those who live with great anxiety and doubt, and any who are fearful of what tomorrow might bring. God of the way, open the eyes of those who are struggling so that they may see that there is a new way filled with hope for them and with the promise of rest and renewal. In Christ, Lord, we know you are the truth. You reveal the falsehood and lies that ensnare us in these confusing times. We pray for those, Lord, who have put their faith in false hope and flimsy promises, those who are deceived by the fabrications of the power hungry, and any who are misled by distortions and twisted claims that circulate each day. God of truth, reveal the shallowness of things that distract or mislead us and empower us to see what is true. In Christ, Lord, we know you as the life, your promise to overcome all that is rooted in death and decay by your resurrecting power. We pray for people who struggle with illness or grief, and all who live with deep sadness, depression, and hopelessness. We lift before you the Sullivans, Evelyn Furness and her family, Suzanne Leach and her family, David Hicks Jr. and his family. Lord, we lift up before you also Joe Leatham, Mary, and the family. We also pray for Brenda Moreham's son, Gavin, who is in Central America and not able to come home at this time. Give him your peace, Lord, and we pray for a way that he can come home again. Lord, we pray for those for whom each day seems like a chore, for those for whom opportunities for abundant life are cut down by acts of discrimination or the loss of what seemed like security just weeks ago. God of all life and each life, heal those who are suffering and make your justice known in our land. Help each of us and your whole church to follow in the footsteps of Christ so that in our living and loving, your kingdom of justice and love is revealed. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. It is now time for our sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And I want to invite everyone to come to the table of the Lord. We're all invited. Christ died for all of us and says, Come to me, all you who are weak and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to the Lord as we celebrate today. As Christ says, Do this in remembrance of me because we so easily forget. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen. And shall we sing our hymn of preparation, hymn number 540, One Bread, One Body. Shall we say together the Apostles' Creed as we celebrate our faith and we confess it? In one voice, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It's now time for a prayer of thanksgiving.
Shall we pray? We praise you and give you thanks for sending your loving and beloved Son into the world. Conceived by the Holy Spirit, he brings new life. Born of Mary's flesh, he knew joy, pain, love, and loss. Touching the sick, he heals us. Breaking bread and sharing the cup with those on the margins, proclaim the good news of your kingdom. Dying on the cross, he is with us in our suffering. Rising from the grave, he brings us to him and gives us life everlasting. In him you have reconciled us, and you lead us out of fantasy into truth, out of solitude into relationship, out of death into life. Remembering these things, we gather at his invitation to break bread and share the cup, and we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Gracious and giving God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered around your holy table, and on these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be for us the body and the blood of Christ, and that we, being nourished by them, may be for the world the body of Christ, made strong, made new, and redeemed by his blood. And now, through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, and with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship and adore you, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. It's now time for us to celebrate the elements. Dear people of God, on the night before he died, our Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke the bread and said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant sealed in my blood. Every time you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time you eat the bread and you drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Take, eat, remember and believe that the body of Christ was broken in love for you. Take, drink, remember and believe that the blood of Christ was shed for you for complete forgiveness of all your sins. We as a congregation, we celebrate communion with the whole people of God. It doesn't matter what age you are. We are all God's children. This is the body of Christ, broken for you, Jackie.
Thank you.
This is the blood of Christ, shed for you for a complete remission, forgiveness of all your sins.
This is the body of Christ broken for you.
Thanks be to God.
Ed, this is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. Shall we pray? Dear God, we thank you for this holy mystery of the Lord's Supper, where you have revealed yourself to us. As we are nurtured through this celebration and strengthened to go out into the world to proclaim the gospel, let us remember that you are with us, to guide us,
us, our actions and our thoughts, and to help us to remember, Lord, that we are truly followers of you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please join us in singing our final song of praise, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Now for us to celebrate birthdays. This is something we do traditionally in our worship service, and I have three birthdays that I just want to highlight at this time. Angelina Ahn, birthday is May the 12th. Ellie Park, whose birthday is May the 13th. And Jean Much, whose birthday is May 14th. And there's others that we're not mentioning here that also have a birthday. Happy birthday to you. And shall we sing together? Wherever you are.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, everyone. Please join us in the peace and the benediction. How beautiful on the mountains
are the feet of the messenger bringing good news,
breaking the news that all is well,
proclaiming good items, announcing salvation,
saying, your God reigns. Amen.
Amen.
And receive the blessing of the Lord and go in peace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and the communion and the guidance and the love of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you always, this day, tomorrow, the day after that, and forevermore. Amen.